This is a DEC PDP-11 from 1970. It was an important milestone in computer history and also helped shape the UNIX operating system. From the moment I learned that this machine can run an early form of BSD, I wanted to have one.
At least until I saw the real thing in life size in a computer museum. The question is, will I be happy with an emulated replica, namely the PiDP-11, that I even have to assemble on my own?
Retro computing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. So I got myself a little Christmas present, which is this PiDP-11 kit from which you can build a miniaturized PDP-11. Actually, only the main front panel of it, behind of which sits a Raspberry Pi, which in turn runs the SimH simulator. It was sitting on the shelf a good while now, but finally I got around building it. As suggested in the build instructions, I start by preparing the Raspberry Pi first, so to speak, installing the operating system and the SimH packages. I would furtherly set the startup options accordingly, so when the Raspberry Pi starts, it'll run directly into SimH instead of the graphical UI. Now let's see what's there in the back. It starts with the electronics backplane, gazillions of switches and LEDs. Here we have the outer frame. Have a look at this. The front panel cover is beautifully crafted. It looks a bit dull, but that's because of the protective foil. I think I'm having the main parts ready now, so I throw an eye at the documentation. It seems quite comprehensive and easy to follow. I will put some more parts aside, as basically what I need right now is the electronics backplane to begin with. For the first phase, I will unwrap all electronic components that will be mounted to the backplane. It's mise en place, which means arrange all similar parts together so it's easier to work with afterwards. But I will still not jump into the soldering right away. Beforehand, I'm about to bend all leads of the resistors and diodes into the correct spacing position. We'll start with inserting the diodes. Please pay attention that these are polarized, so the orientation matters. The black ring denotes the negative pole, and this should align with the ring on the drawing on the PCB itself. Don't worry, the instruction also explained this into detail, so you can't do wrong if you follow the instructions to the point. I'm temporarily fixating the components using paper tape, so they hold in place while I'm doing the soldering. For the front panel LEDs, it's a bit more cumbersome for the preparation work. For everything to line up neatly, there's spaces included and accordingly all LEDs must be fitted into them. And after this is done, I can start adding this endless armada of LEDs onto the PCB. The kit includes this nice bracket that slides onto the LEDs. It's as important that you do this before soldering, as it will properly align all the LEDs into place. A word of importance and warning. The instructions mention this explicitly, and I can only emphasize on this one. When you mount the Raspberry Pi, you will have areas where the soldering joints of the PCB will make undesired contact with the Raspberry Pi. As per the recommendation, it's so important to build something to insulate the two from each other to prevent any potential short circuit scenarios. I cut a piece of foam plastic to act as an insulation layer for that purpose. This is what it looks like. This should get you the idea for the extra protection layer. The build instructions recommend to perform a first functional test at this stage to see if the front panel works so far. So with the Raspberry Pi in place, let's boot the system. Upon startup, all LEDs will light up. As given in the build instructions, testing at this point involves closing some circuits manually, which would trigger some actions in SimH. There's not too much to see right now, but it gives already some idea if the assembly so far was successful or not. The next step is to mount the front bezel to the outer frame, because next after we're about to mount the switches. The switches come along with this mounting bracket, which must be broken into two halves. To begin with, I'm grouping all similar switches together. There's red and purple ones, momentary and latching ones. Then I'll insert the left outermost switch. I'll slide in one of the two alignment rails before I put the other switches into place. Once all switches are placed, the actual alignment procedure starts. I think this was the most cumbersome part during the assembly, but those two alignment rails and the included zip ties definitely help to accomplish this. First, you slide the lower alignment rail up. It shall not lay flat on the PCB, but be somewhat floating 5mm above it, just beneath the upper ends of the switches. Then you slide the second alignment rail over the switches from the top. And finally, the two rails are affixated to each other using the zip ties. This will help in aligning all switches into the correct position with an exact spacing. For the soldering of the switches, I will do one lead per switch per time and run through the entire line. Then I start over to do the next lead. This will give the switches some time to cool down and not overheat during the soldering process. Once everything is soldered, you can clip off the zip ties and remove the upper alignment rail. You can't remove the lower rail, it just stays where it is, but you push it back down so it just lays flat on the main PCB. At the very last, I'm adding the nuts and screws so I can then mount the PCB behind the front bezel. The back panel provides for pre-cut breakout openings, which allow installing panel mount connector sockets. I'm about to mount one for the USB-C power supply, a standard HDMI socket, two USB sockets and two RS232 DB9 connectors. The only challenge here provides for the proper spacing. Sometimes the mounting holes won't align neatly. Other times, the back panel proves a bit too thick and I need to remove a bit of the material to mount the sockets properly, so they have the proper outer distance for the plug to be properly inserted. Eventually, I would connect everything temporarily to get on with the functional testing. And remember what I said about the proper outer distance for the inserting of the plugs? It turns out it's still not good enough for the USB-C plug to make proper contact, so I have to plug it into the Raspberry Pi directly. I will definitely have to adapt the backplate once again to get the missing 1-2mm to properly seat the cable. On the front panel, there's a key switch, which by default is unwired. It's left to yourself what you do with it, whether you use it as a power switch or as a shutdown switch, or anything else. I'm still a bit undecided, but I will add two breadboard patch wires so I can hook them up to standard headers later on. The front panel is intended to sit on this wood piece that comes along with the kit. As the wood piece comes unfinished, it needs some treatment to become visually appealing. I use a grinder to smoothen the surface and make some nice edges. Unfortunately, I ended up tearing off a splinter. It's on the backside anyway, but that's no argument to just rip it away. Hence, I will try to glue it back into place. Then, eventually, I'm applying the paint. I'm using a dark oak paint here to give it the impression of hardwood. It is intended that the entire panel will be just placed freely onto the wood piece. Though I want to fixate it properly, so I'm going to drill in some holes to put some screws. One challenge is the mounting sequence. As there is an embossed area on the backside, which clearly forces you to mount the back panel first, there's no way you could secure the screws from the inside. So what I'm about to do is to drill in some holes big enough so I can secure the screws with some nuts from the underside. And this is what it will look like. I will have to briefly disassemble it again to mount the electronics afterwards. There is actually multiple options to connect the system console. The most obvious one is the HDMI output, but for authenticity, serial VTIs it is. The PiDP-11 board has solder joints for headers, which are linked to the Raspberry Pi's onboard serial lines. In order to use this, the serial UART support must be enabled using the Raspi config utility. Also, you must ensure /boot/commandline.txt contains a statement for the serial console. Once these prerequisites are met, you'll see the boot messages also appear on the onboard serial console. As you may notice, I have hooked up my laptop using a USB to TTL adapter, but actually I want to use a TTL to RS-232 panel mount adapter like the two that I had installed earlier. However, the RS-232 adapter would not be supplied with power, even though I connected it to the 5V line on the header. After reading documentation, the 5V pin seems to be intended for power input and not power output. The breadboard area on the PCB has a 5V and ground rail. After a measurement confirmed me a 5V reading, I decided to solder a single header pin so I could steal away the 5V I needed to power the RS-232 adapter. And hey, it doesn't look too ugly, and it works. The adapter status LED finally lights up. One thing to notice is the SIM-H console, which is displayed directly on the system console on the HDMI output, but not on the serial line. In order to get the SIM-H console via the serial line, simply log in using the Pi account. You'll actually be connected right away to the SIM-H then. The PiDP-11 software comes with many operating system choices. To select the proper one, it reads the front panel switches. As I'm up to a quick test with 2.11 BSD, the panel switches 1 and 6 must be toggled up to select 2.11 BSD in SIM-H. SIM-H is however not configured to boot straight away. It will wait at the initial prompt, from which you must press Enter for the operating system to boot. But beware, 2.11 BSD is set to enter single user mode by default, so you end up on this very minimalistic shell. To continue booting into multi-user mode, press Ctrl-D. From here on it looks quite familiar, like literally every Unix-like system booting up. Now with 2.11 BSD up and running, it's time to think about the extra serial lines. There's two RS-232 TTL adapters that I had connected to the Raspberry Pi using USB to TTL adapters. Now I would like to pass these two serial lines into SIM-H. First, I need to detach from the SIM-H console. This goes by pressing Ctrl-A and Ctrl-D, then you drop out to the Linux command line. From there, enter /opt/pidp11/system/211bsd directory from where I open up the boot.ini for editing. Here I connect the TTY USB 0 and TTY USB 1 adapters to lines 1 and 2 respectively. But apparently, after booting SIM-H and 2.11 BSD with these settings applied, I would get no reaction when connecting my laptop to either of the two serial ports. Again, I was doing some research and learned that the lines must be configured as modem. So I added a modem statement to both serial lines in boot.ini. Weirdly enough, on SIM-H startup, it would only tell me of line 2 being in modem mode, but not line 1. When testing the serial line connections, at least TTY02 was now responding, whereas TTY01 was, no surprise, not responding. So I went back at boot.ini, adding a -m clause to the attach DC statement and removing the modem clause again. And finally, the Pi's native serial console and also the two USB consoles were finally working. One thing to note. The two serial ports connected to SIM-H are in 7-bit mode, so you need different settings for the serial connection. As I know now that all my serial lines are working, I'm up to the final assembly. I start by mounting the third RS-232 adapter for the Raspi serial console. Then I mount the PCB into the casing and do some tidying of the backplane cables using zip ties. When I tried mounting the backside panel, I realized that's not gonna work. The HDMI connector adds up to 4 cm in depth, which is too much. I had it removed to continue. I will need to find another one, which is angled and requires less height spacing. With the HDMI connector out of the way, I can now easily mount the backside panel. Don't forget to mount the knobs on the front panel. For stupid people like me, who tend to forget things, I'm also adding some nice labels to indicate what each serial port is supposed to be. And lastly, I fixate the case to the wooden stand so it can't fall off. Finally, I'm bringing the system up after it's fully assembled. How nice to enjoy a retro serial console and these blinking lights.
And this concludes my look into the PiDP-11, a miniaturized replica of the original PDP-11, which has found its place just beside my other replica of a famous 70s machine, the Altair 8800. There's so much more to do here, such as exploring the vast amount of historic operating systems. Also, I didn't bother yet for the networking setup on 2.11 BSD, but it would be nice to run a web server from it, even maybe connect it to the internet for that purpose. Also, I read up some articles how to install 2.11 BSD from tape archives. That would definitely be an undertaking on its own. Granted, the PiDP-11 software collection spares you those efforts, and it's indeed very nice for a quick start. Though, as you have seen, things don't always work straight away. There's still some level of adaptations and customizations needed to make things work. I hope you liked this video. If you have any suggestions on this or future topics, then please let me know in the comments below. See you next time.